What up, YouTube? TK here, and yes, we are finally back with the Scooter Project. Let's go. In our last episode, we finally got a handle on the speed controller. We threw in a couple of FETs and put them in parallel to deal with the extra current draw. And it went really, really well for about 5 minutes until the motor burned out. Today, we're gonna put in something a little beefier. There are a few things to consider about this install before we get started. One of them is that the new motor has a different pitch chain sprocket on it than the stock Razor E300 sprocket. So to deal with this, we've got a new rear sprocket, a new chain, and because I no longer want to be a masochist, I got a chain breaking tool to make it easy to work with. The next consideration is where we put the motor. Now we could try and cheat and make it easy and put it on top like this. However, if we then try and put our foot plate on, you can see we've actually got a lot of modification to do if we want that to work. I don't really like that solution, so we're going to flip it upside down, I reckon, and try and put it on that way. But to investigate this, we first have to take off the chain cover. Right away, trying to fit this up, we can see there are fitment issues. As we try to move the motor up and backwards, we can get close. However, we're fouling on this, which is a mounting for the kickstand and the cable for the brakes. Other than that, it doesn't actually look too bad. Obviously, I do still want brakes, but I think I can figure out a solution to move that. But we'll get started by removing the kickstand. I love the kickstand, but for power, it's gotta go. To everyone that says I couldn't hack it, here we go. Dob John. Of course, the one side effect of removing the kickstand is that it makes the scooter 47% more annoying to work on, but these are the sacrifices you have to make for power. For those of you that are new to this sort of thing, don't forget to clean up your cuts after you make them. I did make a mistake, which we all do from time to time. My first attack with the grinder on that bracket for the kickstand was way off, and I've actually gouged the frame here, but it'll live. I've actually just found another fitment issue. If I need to get this motor in here and keep the chain drive straight, which is very important, the body of the motor actually fouls on the frame rail here. So I'm probably gonna deal with that in the only way I know how, which is a hammer. Ideally I'd use a ball peen hammer, but I don't have one today, so we're just going to go in with the standard. Anvil underneath is important to avoid buckling the frame, or, well, no, we are trying to buckle the frame. We don't want to bend the frame. Well, that was a pain. Now we want to make changes to the brake actuation because the motor is fouling on the brake cable here. So we're going to flip this bracket around and change this bolt. And that should allow us to send the brake cable out this way instead, giving us more room for the motor. So we're looking at the original setup here. You can see we have this first bracket, and then here we have this second bracket, which is actually the lever that actuates the brake. As you pull on the brake lever, the cable gets tighter, activating the brake. What we're going to do is to kick this cable out further away from that part of the frame. We're going to bring that bracket around here, and we're going to clip that on like that. Now, as you can see, that's not the tidiest way of doing it, but it is very quick. This may look like a fine setup on the face of it, however, there is a problem. Because you see, the pull line of the cable is no longer aligned with the direction we need the brake lever to actually move. So rather than moving cleanly in a straight line, the lever is getting pulled up at the same time because the cable is in this direction. That's bad. That's going to cause this to bend over time, or possibly bind on components in the brake assembly, all of which is going to make our brakes not work after a while. So we may stick with this for initial testing, but that does need to be improved. The brake cable interfaces with the brake bracket through this special bolt with a hole in it. To make our modification work properly, we're going to have to make our own one of these bolts, but a little bit longer. So it's going to take some careful drill work, which is made all the worse by the fact that I don't have a drill press. Wish me luck. To completely brake line relocation, our friendly neighborhood machinist has made us this special bolt, which allows us to skew the brake line out one way. It's been ground down either side to have a flat on it so that it fits into the slot on the brake lever. It has a spacer and a hole ever so delicately drilled through it for the brake line, and it should do rather nicely. The ground flat edges line up with the flats on the bracket itself, and it all assembles rather tidily. So this was a very useful piece to have. We're just going to hammer over this nodule on the first bracket there, so that under braking, this bracket doesn't rotate. Should lock into the frame nicely. Almost as good as a bought one. Next, to make sure our brakes are working as effectively as possible, we're just going to drill a hole through here and add a little bolt to make sure this bracket doesn't rotate when we actually pull on the lever. Go ahead and put our tiny little bolt in. Go ahead and assemble it with the spacer. Wiggle, wiggle, wiggle. Mint. Not mint. Maybe that's not mint. You can see that the bracket and the actuator lever are actually not in line. That was my stupid fault for folding over this little ear. We're going to take that screw out, we're going to cut that ear off and relocate it a little bit, but then we should be good. Awesome. So before we go any further with mounting the motor or playing with the brakes, we'll go ahead and take this rear wheel off and change over to the new sprocket. Now, we're changing for two reasons. One is because our motor actually has a T8F sprocket on it instead of the number 25 chain sprocket that the old setup had. So it's easier to just put a T8F sprocket on the rear wheel as well. The other reason we're doing it is to change the gear ratio. We want to gear the thing more for top speed than for acceleration, because the thing is going to have so much torque, it's going to want to lift the rear wheel every time we hit the throttles. Now, we want to go fast anyway, so why not get a bit more top speed and make the thing more drivable at the same time? We'll get stuck into it. Now, it's a good idea at this point to actually get some footage as you take the wheels off, because that way, when you can't remember which way around all these spacers go, you'll be able to refer back and get it correct. After somewhat of a struggle, we got the rear wheel off. It is time to undo these and fit a new sprocket. Wonder how easy this is going to be. Yeah, not too bad. Nice big hefty Phillips head. Making short work of this. What's still holding you on? Nothing, is it nothing? Come on. There we go. Oh yeah. That's what we like to see. So the stock sprocket had 56 teeth. We're switching to one with 44. By changing the gear ratio like that, we're actually going to get more top speed, which is the whole point of this project. And it's also going to reduce the tendency for the scooter to try and lift its front wheel, because there won't be as much torque going through the rear wheel. Let's go ahead and get it bolted up. The key to doing anything like this is making sure that the sprocket you buy will actually fit your rear wheel slash hub slash whatever. I was very careful to make sure it had exactly the same bolt pattern and hole in the center so that it would fit this scooter. Like any sort of rotating assembly, you don't want to just tighten up one bolt at a time all the way. You want to go around, do a couple turns, and sort of snug them up bit by bit before you actually go all the way, because that means you're much more likely to get the thing on there sitting straight rather than having it canted over one way or the other. All right, that's feeling pretty good. Let's get it all back together. Once you've got it all bolted up, it's good to give it a spin just to check that you've got the thing on there straight. That looks pretty good to me. I find it takes a little bit of persuading with the old hammer just to tap the axle back in, but that's good. That's fine. It's all fine. Go ahead and get these washers back on in the correct order. Now, it's important to grab a couple of spanners and get this back on tight, because you do not want your wheel coming off while you're tearing down the road at, you know, 30 k's an hour. We can see with our chain on that it just fits on the tensioner, and it should clear the chassis as well, which is awesome. So we will keep going. All right, there is a slight fit issue in that these bolt heads are hitting on this little tab underneath here. So as we rotate, you can see they just tap it, but we'll just grind that off and we'll be all good to go. I do want to have a little bit of a brag here. This is just beautiful. I threw an extra little washer in the bracket holding the brake drum on, as well as grinding off that little nib that was getting in the way of these bolts on the sprocket. And now that we've got it all back together, watch this. Oh, isn't that just beautiful? Dead straight, silent, and nothing is fouling. It's just perfect. With that done, it now means it's time to try and figure out how to bolt this motor on. And it's a little bit difficult because the ears of the motor's mount don't actually line up very well with the frame rails on the scooter. But we'll have a play. Look at this beautiful thick chain. That's just stunning. Oh, I'm in heaven. All right, now there are two keys to a successful chain drive system. One is tension. Now we have a little tensioner in here. As long as we get the chain length roughly correct by removing links, that'll be fine. Second is alignment, and it's really important we get these as close to dead straight as possible. So that's a little off. That's still a little off. Right there's about tasty. And that should do very nicely for our chain drive. All right, we've done a terrible job on those drill holes. They're not even close to centered. So this is gonna be fun to try and widen them out. All right, the trick is to drill in stages. So we started with a 3mm bit. We've now gone up to a 5.5, and then we'll probably step up to the final size for these bolts here that will hold the motor on. It just makes life a lot easier on the drill bit and stops you wandering around so much. Trying out WD-40 as a cutting fluid because I've never used cutting fluid before. We'll just use a bigger drill bit to just sort of essentially countersink these, just taking the edge off so we don't cut ourselves and so the bolts can sit nice and cleanly. And that's all good. We've drilled two of the holes which mount directly to this frame rail here, and that's awesome. It's all bolting up and looks nice and straight. For the other side, we've got this weird L-shaped bracket I'm working on to help it all just run together a little better. That needs a bit of filing because at the moment it's not even close to straight, but once that's done, we can keep going on bolting it up. So if you're really tricky and you need to cut a straight line in a piece of L angle, you can actually use your vise as a guide for the hacksaw and you'll get it nice and straight. Straighter than I did the first time anyway. We're just going to sit here and arduously file this bracket until it fits with our motor and the frame, and then we should be good to drill it and bolt it up. Lots of filing. So we've marked up our little bracket here that's going to help hold the motor on, and center tapped it. So now we'll just go ahead and drill just like the other piece. The reason we made this bracket is because we needed to bridge the gap between the frame rail here and the motor mount. And we've drilled the holes in it and it seems to line up pretty nicely. So with this and the other holes all drilled, we can now go ahead and mount the motor, which is awesome. I think this clamp actually works really well. Holding things on there nice and tight. With all that bolted up, the motor's on there nice and firm. I'm not in love with this clamp as a long-term solution, but to get us up and running and testing the new motor, it should be good. I'm really keen to see how it goes. The one thing that is stopping me from jumping right out on it now, though, is we've got a huge motor, which is going to put even more load on the FETs. I don't want it to blow up while I'm riding it at 40 k's an hour down the street and throw me into a pole, so I'm going to install some kind of safety cutout so I can actually yank the power when I need to. But for now, things are progressing and it is very exciting. So we're working in somewhat humble accommodations today. There's no proper lighting here, so we've just got a couple of light bulbs to help us out. We're gonna go ahead and wire up the motor and a special safety cutout so that when we test this thing and it blows up, we don't die. So this here is our safety mechanism. What this is a fuse holder with a 100 amp fuse with a rope tied around it. The reason we have this is it allows us to cut the power to the scooter in an emergency. Basically, when it all goes wrong, if the MOSFETs jam hard on, we yank this fuse and the scooter comes to a stop, rather than sending us spearing off into a tree or breaking an ankle or all manner of other horrible things. We're going to wire this in line with the original power switch and find a good place to bolt it on the scooter. We're going to yank one of these power connectors going to the main switch and wire in our cutout fuse there, which should be good. right about there is where I'm looking at mounting the fuse holder. Don't normally like working on workshop stuff this late, but I figure you've all been waiting for the scooter video long enough.
I gotta tell you, laying flat on the floor on my stomach is not my favorite position for a lot of things, and that includes soldering.
Good news is, soldering's going down, and we're getting there.
One lesson you will learn very quickly is to always check that you've put the heat shrink on the cables before you start soldering, because otherwise you'll make the best solder joint of your life, maybe even in the history of the world, and then you'll realize you haven't put the heat shrink on, and so you have to cut it all apart and start again, and you will do the absolute worst, snottiest solder joint ever at that point, and you'll just feel so depressed. Make sure the heat shrink's on there. Get it right the first time. Something you will come to hate when you start working with this really big heavy gauge wire is the fact that it doesn't bend very well. You can see that I don't have a lot of choice as to where to put these cables. You get used to it though, eventually. I'm just gonna zip tie this fuse assembly down now, and that should be good. Just with two zip ties, that's hanging on there really firm. That's actually way better than I thought. I don't think we're actually going to need anything other than just the zip ties there. It's a shame we're going to have a bit of cable hanging out the side here, but down the track I'll find a way to fix that. That's awesome. Now, a demonstration of how this is going to work. Here we have the 100 amp fuse with its cable tied around it. Pop that in, circuit's complete, we can run the scooter. Come up here, we have our little safety pull, and oh no, we're having an accident. Drop straight out, which is awesome. I'm a little bit worried that now the fuse comes out too easily after I've tested this five or six times, because obviously this is a fuse holder. It's not meant as a quick release of any kind. But frankly, I'd rather have the scooter not work because the quick release is too tenuous a connection, rather than be flying down the road at 40 kilometers an hour and have it stuck and not come out and then I crash. Mocking things up here, we've got the batteries connected so we can check that the motor's turning in the right direction. So we'll power on, and that is spinning the correct way, spinning forward. All right, the motor is all wired up. It is now time to break the chain. The chain wraps really tightly around the motor's cog there, but that's okay. We're just lining it up on the back here. Looks like we probably want to cut it there, and the tensioner here should take care of the rest. We don't actually want it too tight. Having a bit of slack and it's good. This tool here is a chain breaking tool. It's a great little tool off eBay for $20. Basically, what this allows you to do is crank this handle, which drives this shaft forward, which pushes the pins out of the chain, allowing you to take it apart. Very handy. Now we've got the chain in place in the tool. We want to take out the pin in this blue link. So all we got to do is line it up and crank away. It's not easy, but it gets the job done. All right, that's just gone through. So if I undo that, there we go, our chain is broken. And this is how you put the chain back together. It's a pain in the ass, but it's gotta be done. All right, the chain is on. There's a little bit more slack in it than I would like, but it should be good for now, and that's still better than it being too tight. All we have to do now is reassemble the scooter, put everything back together, and we are ready to test. I am psyched. Let's go. All right, quick test before we put the top on. It spins. Time to go. Okay, we've got everything laced up. I'm a little bit nervous. I've got the thermocouple back on the speed controller so we can see if it's gonna overheat. And most importantly, we have the special emergency safety cutout for when it all goes bang and I get flung into a tree. Other than that, it's hot and I'm tired, so it's a perfect time to give it a go. You can tell there's trepidation in my voice. On. Get ready to get hurt. Not. Whoa, that's quick. Whoa. Whoa. Whoa.
Jesus, that didn't sound good. Ah, no, it's all over.
Oh my god.
For the 3 seconds that worked, that was quick as hell. I could barely stay on the thing. And then something mechanical broke, which is nice. Better than the electronics breaking because it's quicker to fix. Oh, all right, we'll leave it there. We'll tear it apart.
All right, so actually it wasn't that bad. It was just the chain jumping off. If we just spin up the motor, we can see that still works fine. So
all we got to do is sort out the chain a little bit and we can go again. But for now, I'm going to get some rest. Holy crap, it does actually kind of work. That is awesome.
All right, we've tightened up the chain. Round two. Still pretty nervous. That was a moderately successful first test. The speed controller did not overheat. The chain stayed on. It felt a little slow, to be honest, given the huge power increase, but it was a good start. Nothing broke. So we'll throw the GPS in the pocket and see how we go.
Well, I've given it a spin up and down the street. Good news, it runs fine. It hasn't blown up. The speed controller's not getting too hot. Bad news, we're only going 23 kilometers an hour. That is not what we expected. And you know, people have done builds in the past, they've done a lot better than that. I think the problem we're having now is we've tightened the chain, but it's too tight. It is incredibly firm, and I'll show you. If you're ever looking at a chain drive and you're wondering if it's too tight, well, this is a great example. I'm pushing really hard here, and there's only a couple mils of slop in it. There really should be more like 5 to 10. It's really difficult to actually turn the motor. This is ripping the hell out of the bearings. In fact, the motor, I'm hoping, isn't already bent to crap, but yeah, that's probably the biggest cause of our problem right now. If we look straight down, we can see that the chain has been so tight it's actually shifted the motor off axis. We're going to try and drill these holes and kick the motor back a couple mils and see if that just frees things up a little. So obviously I'm sick of waiting to drive this thing. I did a quick and dirty hack and just slotted these mounts to try and loosen up the chain. And you see we've got a proper amount of slack in it now. It should be a bit quicker. What I realized though is when I did order this new big motor, I didn't actually check its rated RPM versus the rated RPM of the old motor. You see, the old motor was a 24 volt motor overvolted to roughly 36, which meant it was probably spinning almost, say, 50% faster than usual, whereas this will be spinning at its rated speed. So we actually could be short on RPM in terms of chasing top speed. We've got more power now, but we don't have the right gear ratio. So we're going to test this again, but I have a feeling to really go fast, we're going to have to swap this front sprocket. Regardless, let's bolt her up and see how we go.
All right, round three. Definitely rolls better. I'll switch to GPS.
All right, the bad news, it's not fast enough. We fixed the chain. We're still only hitting 24 kilometers an hour. The good news is the motor works. Speed controller works. It's only hit 41 degrees after a big hot lap around the block, and it's like 30 degrees ambient, so that's a good sign. One thing we have to do is change the gearing. We need a bigger gear on the motor so that the back wheel spins faster. Simple as that, we'll go quicker. We've got the power, we just don't have the speed. And last but not least, I want a variable throttle. I want it real bad, because when you're actually trying to go somewhere on one of these and just ride it around, it's really cool when you can just cruise, go slow on bumpy stuff, get around corners without then having this big jerk as you hit the throttle. It's really stressful to ride. It's a lot more fun when you can actually just dial it. But that just means there's a lot more work to do. So far, everything's going well. It's just a development process, and I'm having a lot of fun. So, till next time, TK out.